talk about the use of a VirtualioNet device as a failover device in a live migration.
Okay, hi everyone. Now I'm the guy between you and lunch. I'll try to make it not too long. So my name is Jens Freimann. I work for Red Hat. I work in the virtualization team. And most recently, I've worked on a feature called failover for VirtualioNet. And the part that I worked on was in the host. So today I want to talk about why this is an interesting problem that we could solve. What's the problem exactly? We'll look at some existing solutions for this. And then in the last part, that's mostly me thinking out loud how we could bring this into the VirtualioNet driver and DPDK. So the problem is, I have a virtual function that's assigned to a virtual machine, and I want to use it because it gives me fast networking. But at the same time, at some point, I might want to be able to migrate my virtual machine to another system, and that means I also need, or that I also want the flexibility of a power virtualized device like VirtualioNet. NetVSC is another one. So I want it fast and flexible, but I also want to be able to migrate my virtual machines. So need to migrate, at the, that would mean I need to use a virtual VirtualioNet device. That comes, but that has downsides too, because VirtualioNet traffic over it will be not as fast as via the virtual function. You will not have the same amount of throughput. You will have higher latency, and it will use more of your CPU cycles. So we should try to combine the two. And now let's look at migration. So I divided into four big steps here for explaining it. It's basically, and this was supposed to be a highly sophisticated animation, but it's the PDF version. So it's basically you have a virtual machine running, and you take away the virtual function on the source side. You unplug it, the hypervisor unplugs it. Then data traffic is switched over to the VirtualioNet pass. You run your migration. You start your virtual machine on the target system, and it starts again with the VirtualioNet device, but you replug the virtual function and then switch the data path again so it can flow through the virtual function. So back to your original state. So the unplug step, it means in QMU as the hypervisor, so migration is triggered by some management software, libvirt. But QMU eventually will trigger the unplug request to the guest operating system. And so now here we have to wait for completion if it was, when was the device really unplugged from the guest operation, from the guest operating system. The next step then would be to somehow switch over the traffic to the power virtualized device. Power virtualized device is emulated in software, so it can be easily migrated. That's been working for a very long time. So you start the actual migration. You need a new migration state so that management applications will know what's going on. So at the moment you have states like migration is in setup, migration is active, migration is finished, and a few more. You need something that says, okay, well, I'm waiting for an unplug from the guest operating system too. And you need a couple of new events to tell libvirt what device was unplugged and that it was unplugged in a special way too. And then on the target system, we need to replug the VFR device, and we want to do that in an automatic way. So there's a few. There's a lot of complication, a lot of things that can go wrong here too, and that we all need to handle. So most of it goes back to need to be able to roll back state into what it was before we triggered the migration. So let's say we unplug the device from the guest, but for some reason the guest operating system, it never responds, or it takes a very long time to respond to this request. That would mean the migration is stuck for this whole time. And it also a way for a malicious guest operating system to basically prevent a migration for a virtual machine. Okay, say we have successfully unplugged this device, but migration for some other reason is going wrong, and we have to abort it. We need to stay on the source host system. But we already unplugged the device completely from the guest operating, and we released all the resources that were assigned to it in QMU. Things like memory pinnings, IMMU stuff, all these file handles, all these things. We already freed them, and we have no guarantee to get it back exactly the way it was. So that's something that we solved by only partially unplugging the device from the guest operating system and keeping as many resources as we can on standby until we know that the migration is finished successful. So this is the problem and some of the complications that come with it. But there must be solutions for this already, right? This is not the first time that somebody thinks about this problem. And of course, there are solutions. You can do bonding, and of course, it's possible to bond a virtual function and a virtual net device configured in like an active backup configuration. And things like this are shown to be working in both DPDK stack and with the Linux networking stack. Problem here is that it requires a lot of configuration, manual configuration, even in the guest operating system. And that's what we would like to avoid. So we would like to have it as much automated as possible. In DPDK, there are solutions for this too, and the first one was VDefNet VC and Failsafe, so it was a new PMD that basically controlled the Failsafe PMD, which then in turn controlled a TAP PMD that controlled a NetVSC device, and another one that controlled the PMD for the virtual function. So bit of a complicated setup, and I think it was considered a temporary solution basically from the beginning until there was better support for hot plug and DPDK, or until the new NetVSC driver would arrive. So that's one other thing. Then in the Linux networking stack, there's a solution for that too. I worked on the host part of that, but there's guest support too. So there's a feature bit standardized in Virt.io. I think it's in Virt.io 1.1 for this. And there's a kernel module that will run in the guest operating system. It's called netfailover. And basically what this does, it watches for new networking devices showing up, and then if it finds two devices that have the same MAC address, it matches them and configures them into a failover pair. So you would see a failover master device that controls a primary device, which would be backed by the virtual function, and the standby device, which will be backed by the Virt.io net device. And so that support is in since, I think, 4.17. And you can make it work by running custom scripts in a hypervisor that do all the unplug and things like this. Back to DPDK, there's SRIUV support and a NetVSC driver by Microsoft that was done by Stephen Hemminger. And it does in a very smart way. It basically transparently manages the virtual function device from the NetVSC driver. And because they have a VM bus, they can also basically receive messages in a driver that do things like associate it with a virtual function device, or that they can send messages to the host that will make sure that the data path is switched there as well. So those were the existing solutions. Now, how can we make use of this in DPDK? So I haven't really started textual coding. I'm at the stage where I try to think about how we can solve this. And at the moment, I think it's we should follow the NetVSC model and combine that with the support that we have in the host for the NetApp standby feature. So you would start QML with devices, device definitions, and they have a few have extra parameters. That's mostly to match devices for internal QMU state. And then from the VDOA driver, we would try to transparently manage the virtual function device as well. That is, configure it, set it up, start it. Also, go and match devices by MAC addresses. And then do things like setting up a link state, change interrupts, and change receive and transmit functions. So that for transmit, you could basically shortcut the function, and when the virtual function device is attached, you would take, you would put packets into the virtual function device. If not, you go to a standard VDIO pass. For receive, it might look similar. There might be some special cases where you have to look into both. Into both queues. Then at migration time, QMU would be responsible for unplugging the virtual function device as well. And then the question is how can we notify the VDOA driver about this and about what device was unplugged? And that's one of the open questions that I don't have a final answer for. There's a few possibilities. I think the most logical could be just receiving an interrupt from the device to sign this. I think I'm almost at the end of my talk. This is the current state. I plan to work on this and send an initial patch set in the next, say, 2 months, 4 to 6 weeks. Could target it for 2002, unless it turns out to be much more complicated than anticipated. And that was the case when I worked on the QMU solution. It took much longer. It could be the same case here. So we'll see. That's from my side. I think I give us some time back. Are there any questions? Maybe we can take one question and then go on to the next session, so it won't be much late. That one. This one from Amnon.
Have you thought also about the case where you have an obvious offload and how to synchronize with the port representer on the backend side and these kind of problems?
Not much. About port representers, there's I know that I'm in contact with guys from Mellanox who work on patches for port representer support and want to do this switching of the data path in a more in a different way, but other than that, I have not spent too much time on that yet.
Thanks.
But Yeah, I will. Okay. Good. Thank you very much.